Have you had enough yet? Are you ready now?
Every single free choice you make arises from either a thought of love or a thought of fear. There is no other choice. And if I had one thing to say about what we're trying to understand here tonight, it would be this. That feeling inside of you, that love inside of you, that's God expressing through you as you. Yes.
My name is Daisy, and I just wanted to say I loved your book.
Thank you, Daisy.
And I'm feeling like I finally understand what it means to be awake in my own life.
Feels good, doesn't it?
It's totally amazing. I walk around feeling like I've been given a secret.
Well, yeah, the secret is out.
The problem I've been having is that some of my friends, even my family, if I say anything remotely spiritual, they get this glazed look on their face. And I know that look because it's the same look I've had or used to have every day of my life.
I know exactly what that feels like. And the good news is you're not crazy.
Good.
Unless we're both crazy. And if that's the case, we're in very good company. Instead of worrying about what people think about you, concentrate on what you think about you. That's important.
Any regrets?
Many.
Care to name a few?
You're not a lawyer, are you? I wish that I could have come to this point in my life without hurting. Wish I'd come to this point in my life without hurting so many people, especially the people I've loved. But without them, I might not have come to this point in my life. See, it's important for all of us to remember that the universe is conspiring in our favor, always, and in all ways, despite circumstances and appearances, or most importantly, our perception of them.
You've got a lot of nerve.
I'm sorry?
You're a hypocrite.
Sorry.
Standing up there preaching about God and love. You've been married and divorced a lot. If you talk to God, how come you can't keep a commitment with a woman?
can't tell you how many times I've asked myself that same question. The women in my life are all wonderful. They treated me a whole lot better than I treated them. I betrayed them. I let them down. I let my kids down, too. I admit that. More than that, I cannot say without invading their privacy, and that I am not going to do. What I can do is love as much as I can from where I am. To make every gesture and action sponsored by love.
Sounds to me like you've written a book of lies.
If what you're asking me is, did I make all of this stuff up? The answer is no. I've wondered what you're wondering. Will anyone believe me? Believe what I'm saying? Believe where this came from? And I guess that's up to you. To each of you. I only hope that you don't disqualify or marginalize the message because it's coming through such a fallible messenger.
My name is Kay, and I just wanted to thank you for admitting your mistakes.
Well, thank you, Kay, and all of you, but the truth of it is I'm still making those mistakes to this day, and that's why these conversations with God are such a miracle for me. They came out of a need, a desperate personal need for me to change my life. And, if I've been successful at it in the way I'd like, I don't know, but it's the way it happened, and it's the way it's still happening.
My question is, if God has one message, his most important message to all of us, and you could put it into one paragraph, what would it be?
Well, I could fit it into five words. You've got me all wrong.
Here's your plane ticket. You're on the 10 o'clock.
Thanks for everything, and I'll see you in New York. Nothing, huh?
I'm trying, honey.
You could have fooled me. Look, I don't get this. I've got experience.
Your experience has nothing to do with anything, and we've been over this, Neil. Mm. As long as that bow tie's around your neck, nobody's going to take a chance on hiring you.
Really? So what is it exactly that you people do around here?
Mostly, we hand out checks to people who blame us for their problems.
Sorry.
What did the hospital say? Well, they said I should start feeling better in a few days, but it's been almost a month now.
Well, they seem to have missed something.
What?
Neil. You have a broken neck.
Mr. Walsh, it's Michael. Come on, Mr. Walsh. I know you're in there.
No, I'm not.
You're 3 months behind on your rent.
I told you, I lost my...
Your job.
Job, yeah.
Yes, I know. And I'm sorry about your accident, Neil. But I'm not going to lose my job because you lost yours.
Come on, I'm out there. Every day I am. I'm trying.
Isn't there someone you can call?
No, those calls were made a long time ago. I mean, I got nowhere to go.
Five o'clock, Neil.
Thank you. You're doing it wrong!
It's the way I did it on the other side!
Nope, and don't go there! You're doing it wrong! Let me show you how to do it.
What the instructions say!
Nope, and don't go there! Let me show you how to do it. Tie the line to the tree, make it high enough so you don't kill yourself in the middle of the night.
I kinda wish I had one of those old canvas jobs. Like you pitch from the inside. I take it this isn't your first time pitching. Ted.
Please, God, don't let me die here.
To God, there is no separation between financial abundance and spirituality. In fact, they go hand in hand. Don't you find it odd that we live in a society that devalues our most important jobs?
What do you mean by that?
I mean, we have no problem giving a football coach $5 million a season or an actor $10 million per movie, but somehow we've got it wired where people involved with spirituality should be penniless, celibate, and abstinent. And preferably all three. No?
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know about you, but I don't remember voting for any of that. So imagine a world where money was given to people who give us the biggest gifts. Teachers. Artists. Nurses. Firemen, you know, policemen. Writers.
And mothers!
Mothers, yes. Mothers, that's right.
Yes.
People who connect us, not disconnect or distract us. You know, imagine that world, and we can have it. Because people, we're the ones. We've always been the ones that we've been waiting for.
We are. We are.
You awake in there? I said, are you awake in there?
Just a minute.
Morning.
Good morning.
Name is Oscar. How about you step out of that tent for a minute?
What for?
I know you got in late, but I run things around here. You should be aware of the rules.
Rules?
Yeah, I'll walk you through them. How about you come a little bit closer so I don't have to yell?
Okay.
Fair. Rent is $25 per week. Right. Over there, you've got your bathrooms. Now, our maid quit about a month ago, so we'd appreciate it if you would clean up after yourself.
Okay.
Those cabins back there, freight on them, 75 per week.
Already. Right.
Now down by the water, you've got another picnic area. Those are reserved for real campers and real campers only.
Real campers?
They usually arrive by automobile. They tend to stick around a couple of days, then move on. A guy like yourself comes up in the rain with a tent and a bedroll. We call them professional campers around here.
Yeah.
You professionals have a way of lingering on, kind of like those guys over there.
I should be back on my feet in a few days as soon as I find a job.
Because you got in late, last night's on the house. The collection for the week starts on Friday at 3 p.m. If you're here, I expect payment on time. There's no exceptions.
Okay.
If not, you're out. We understand each other?
Yes. Yes, we do.
Well, good morning to you then. And by the way,
yeah?
If I were you, I would put that cover on top of your tent.
What's it for?
For the rain.
I see you have lots of experience. Radio. That says a lot. Why don't you have a resume?
That doesn't matter. How about you tell me why Osborne and Associates should hire someone like you? We have over 20 applicants. Why you?
Well, despite outward appearances, I've held supervising positions for 3 companies.
Yeah, which makes me wonder about your work ethic. Or maybe you're on some type of desultory path. It means lack of purpose.
Yeah, well, the truth of it is I was laid off when the stations were bought out and consolidated. I mean, everything's corporate now, and I'm nearing 50 and so overqualified that you're probably not going to hire me, are you?
Well, the thing of it is, most applicants carry a master's degree. You don't.
No, I don't, but I still think I can do a good job for Osborne and Associates.
Well, around here, we demand excellence. Mr. Walsh, not good. I'm sorry.
Okay, listen, I really need this job.
You're overqualified.
Next! Next, chef. Let's go. Hey, don't let him get to you. Outsiders make him a little bit jumpy, that's all. So I'm guessing you're gonna be sticking around for the week.
I'm sorry.
It's harder than you thought, isn't it? Look, there's a convenience store in the corner. They've got a recycling center. That's how these guys pay their rent. You get yourself a bag of aluminum cans, you're halfway to making a week. Bag a day, you get your food, you get your drink.
No, I don't drink, thanks.
Yeah? Stick around here long enough, you will.
Thank you.
You scared me. What
the hell do you think you're doing?
Well,
these are mine. This is my area. I'm sorry. I didn't know.
No. Now you do.
See him at Oakley.
Yeah, I didn't know there were territories.
Well, we call them areas.
Yeah, well, he could have just told me. I didn't think to give them the damn cans.
Well, a man who relies on threats to communicate usually indicates a weak cause. Hey, don't let it bother you.
Okay.
Sure is pretty, isn't she?
Who is she?
That's Sunny.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind changing her tire, if you know what I mean.
How long have you been saying that?
Dreams don't have deadlines. I got a better chance than you do, you old fart.
I beg to differ.
Then you keep on begging.
Hey, thanks.
You okay?
Well, compared to what?
That's a hell of a point. Yeah. What happened to your neck?
Oh, that's a bull riding accident. It wasn't pretty.
Well, then I'd say today's a better day. It ain't Irish, but it's effective.
No, thanks. I don't drink.
Something wrong with you?
I just never got around to it, really.
Huh. Hell of a thing.
Yeah.
You keep them. I'll help you get going.
All right, what's the catch? Yesterday you looked at me like I ran over your dog.
I don't have a dog. Something you'll soon figure out. People on the street, hardest friends to make. Even tougher ones to lose.
Does it mean we're friends?
Not yet.
Catching up on your reading?
Oh, it's a padding for under my sleeping bag.
Neil, come on in here. Come on. I'm not going to bite you. Come on in here.
You boys hungry?
Neil?
You sure you have enough?
Son, the right dumpster always has enough. Man's just got to know where to look. That's what it is.
Any guacamole?
Sometimes I wonder.
I'm not in the mood, Chef. I'm really not.
Monday, now that's going to be your slow day.
Here we go.
Tuesday and Wednesday, things are going to pick up, but only just a little. Now, your fast food, you're going to see that on Thursday, mostly because folks racing around like a bunch of crazy rats trying to make it through the work week. Why? Because Friday's payday. Now, you take Saturday night, your date night, that's when folks pay most for their food, which is why you'll see the guacamole on Saturday. Why, you ask? It's because of the... Help me out here, Fitch.
Discretionary.
Income, exactly. This is almost done. And Sunday is going to be your slow day because most folks eat at home. Okay, boys, get your plates.
Neil?
Come and get it.
No, but thanks.
Boy's still wet behind his ears.
I'll let him go.
You'll be back.
Yo, do you need something, buddy?
Yeah, the bathroom.
Yeah, we got two bathrooms.
Thank you.
Where do you think you're going?
To the bathroom.
Oh, you need to use the head.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Tell you what, you see across the alley, that tree over there? You see it?
Yes.
Good. Go lift your leg up on that with the rest of the dogs. You people make me sick. Why can't you get a job like everybody else?
What's the problem?
He thinks he's coming inside to use the bathroom.
In and out, okay?
Thank you.
I'm the janitor.
Hi, Harry. Harry, how did you like the book?
Oh, it's wonderful. I've been waiting for this day ever since your name came on the schedule months ago. Oh, well, here, let me show you to the green room.
Yeah, listen, Harry, what did you like about the book?
Oh, I don't want to bother you.
Oh, not bothering me at all. I'm interested.
I spent a lifetime in anger toward my father. I'm not going to stand here and drop sugar all over this because my old man was a mean old cuss. I hated him. Strong words, I know, but true. And this book, your book, helped me finally, after 20 years of that anger, that hatred, to forgive my father. What I was feeling about my father was really what I was feeling about myself. And I had to forgive myself for the feelings I had, the anger I had toward my father. That's the first time I think I've ever said that out loud. Well, here. Page 3. I know your book.
Sure do.
My most common form of communication is through feeling. Feeling is the language of the soul. If you want to know what's true for you about something, look to how you're feeling about it.
Fitch? Can you hear me, Fitch?
Jesus, I'm drunk, not deaf.
Why are you doing this?
I'm not doing anything. Own. I'm just playing the hand I'm dealt. Don't start with me.
You're killing yourself, you know that?
Don't ask me to stop drinking.
I can't do that.
You're gonna be a real pain in the ass, aren't you?
Thank you. Thank you.
Good morning, programming.
Oh, yes, I'm calling about the ad in the paper.
Come again?
excuse me. Could I speak with the program director, please?
He's on air at the moment. What can I help you with?
Well, I'm calling about the ad for the weekend radio DJ. Hello?
That ad wasn't supposed to run until next week.
Well, I'm holding the paper in my hand.
Which paper?
The Ashland Daily Tidings. Sorry, what is the date today?
Today, November 7th. Hello?
No, I'm still here. Sorry. Is there a position available?
Yeah, it's been a revolving door around here for the last 6 months.
Tell you what, how about I take your name and number, and I'll make sure Roy gives you a call.
Is there any chance I could converse with Roy today?
He's extremely preoccupied at the moment, but
I'll see what I can facilitate.
At what number can he reach you?
Yes. He can reach me at 555-7507. And my name is Neil.
Hello, Neil. I'm Leora. Nice chatting with you.
Yes, well, it's been nice chatting with you too, Leora. Thank you. And bye-bye. And look forward to the call.
About you, and he'd like to have you come in tomorrow.
What's happening there, Dennis? Can you get it out of there? Can you lift that thing?
Tomorrow would be great.
There?
Yeah, sure.
Now check, bleed the line. Just bleed the line.
Okay. You know where we are? KYOL.
I gotta get home.
I'm sure I can find you, Leora.
Okay, then we'll see you tomorrow.
Right. Okay. Bye-bye.
Dennis.
Let me get this straight. What you're saying is that we're all having a conversation with God all of the time.
Of course.
Can you give me an example of what you mean by that?
Sure. Do you ever pick up the phone to call someone and they're already on the line? Or do you ever drive down the road feeling as though nothing makes sense of your life and the next song on the radio speaks directly to you? It's as if the lyrics were written specifically for you and suddenly everything falls into perspective. Or what about when someone enters your life seemingly from nowhere and you wonder why they are there, and then one day it all makes sense and you wonder how you ever got along without them?
Of course. Well, we've all had those moments.
That is God.
Well, it happened to him. It can happen to you.
Is happening to you and you.
I stand corrected. We'll be right back with Neil Donald Walsh and his book, Conversations with God.
Thank you.
I knew I had something back there that would work.
Great. And thanks for cleaning up the shirt as well. I'm gonna look employable.
It's only fear.
Well, it's easy for you to say you're not the one going back out there. If it doesn't work.
What if it does? Neil, you're afraid to give up the very thing in yourself that brought you here in the first place.
Give up? I'm running on empty.
And that's why you're here.
Well, no, I'm here because I lost my job.
You're here because you lost yourself.
Well, right now I just want to get this job.
You will. You're ready for that now. This is your opportunity to experience real love.
What did you have in mind?
For you to be a man. A real man, Neil. Not a predator. How many women is it going to take? How far do you need to fall before you realize that your behavior is an attempt to destroy yourself? Feel that. And you'll be free.
Come in, Neil. Let's have a look at you.
Come here.
Didn't I tell you she was some miracle worker?
So how'd it go?
I don't know.
Son, we've been trying to get a look inside her trailer for years. How is it?
It's good.
She make her head spin? She made his head spin.
How are we doing on time? Fitch, you with us?
Yeah, yeah.
Neil, we know what a big deal this is for you. Help you with the bus fare.
And you got enough time to get a hot breakfast, too. Maybe some bacon, eggs, pancakes with syrup, and toast. Don't forget the toast. And some jelly, grape if they have it. And some biscuits, maybe some biscuits
with...
You
eating this breakfast or is it?
Guys.
Thanks.
Go on now.
Yeah, go on, Neil. My man is stepping up.
Funny, huh? What's the big deal if someone wants to look at your watch, right?
Hey, have we met before?
No, I don't think so.
I'm Carly.
Hi.
You come here often?
Name's Neil.
Neil. I'm kidding, of course, because if you had, I would have seen you, right? I'm like a fixture on this bus. Whew, that's me. You'd think one of these days I would buy a car. Nope. I love people too much. I'm a receptionist. I work for a construction company up in Medford. We are getting crazy busy lately. Yeah. No, because the thought of sitting in a car by myself all day long, not for me. I love people. Wait, I said that already, didn't I?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, it's true. Call me crazy.
It's nice meeting you.
Oh, are you getting off?
I think so.
Shoot. God, isn't that just how life is? I mean, people just moving in and moving out, and you never know why. Or if you're ever even going to see them again.
I never thought about it that way.
Makes you think, doesn't it?
Well, goodbye.
Oh, no. You don't get to say goodbye. See you later, till we meet again. Anything but goodbye. I mean, goodbye is something that you say when you walk out on a bad job or you leave a bad lover. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, see you later.
Later.
Hey, now that's what I'm talking about.
Stuff. You've been listening to Fat Friday Morning Freakout Show. Bob and Jane will be here with me on Monday. They got a new book called Breaking Up with Mommy or Daddy or Your Cousin or whatever the damn name is. And they're going to be doing a book signing at Medford Pegasus Bookstore starting at 7 p.m. on Monday. I will be talking to an angry deli worker. He's mad at you idiots who go and order sliced turkey breast and then at the last minute change it over to sliced ham. And then for coming in and at 8 o'clock at night,
good morning,
when their slicers are all cleaned up and everything,
yes,
that's going to be it,
Leora,
for me.
We spoke on the phone.
I'm Rockin' Roy, the morning boy.
Thanks for getting
here
me
on
in.
KYOL.
You're not in yet.
Stay young, stay
cool.
You
still
cool.
have to meet Roy. He's a handful.
You tell Janie I want to talk to her. I don't remember approving this drunk Russian guy for tomorrow's show. Nobody cares about this. I mean, so what? If he drank too much vodka and fell out of a six-story building and lived to tell about it, that's actually pretty funny. Okay, yeah, we go with the drunk Russian guy, but just get me a list of backups in case he turns out to be a dud. And make sure that he is not drunk, because I'd... Who the hell is this?
This is your 9 o'clock. For the weekend slot?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Okay, hi. Hi. Just head in. I'll be right in.
You bet.
Okay? Listen, next time I'm talking about my personal affairs, and it'd be nice if you'd let me know there's someone standing right there.
If you'd take a breath once in a while, I would be happy to.
Just get me the files, all right? Cancel this lunch.
Oh, man.
I am sorry about all these delays. I have had just a crazy month. So how are you? Nick?
Neil.
Neil. Right, okay. Leora is very impressed with you. She says that you have some good experience.
Well, I was on the air for a while in Baltimore and then down south for a few years after that. I've always been around radio in my career. You know what? Listen. I can make people enjoy the sound of leaves falling on the radio.
How do you do that?
You're gonna have to hire me to find out.
What are your Saturday afternoons like?
Saturday afternoon be okay.
It's a four-hour slot. Is that gonna fit in your schedule?
Yeah, that'd be good.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, good. You're hired.
Great.
I'll see you on Saturday. And shut the door.
So I'm going to call you about the new mix.
I think that sounds great, and your ideas were perfect.
Hey, see ya. My ideas were perfect. My ideas were perfect. My ideas were perfect. My ideas were.
Better coming out the box than the dust, the dumpster. Neil, you want another piece?
Yeah, I want another piece of pizza. I brought it, didn't I? So anyway, I look out the window, and she's got this guy, you know. And I think, well, maybe that's not such a bad thing.
Right.
So, you know, it's where I am right now. You know what? I'm with great friends right now, and that's what I'm happy about. So cheers.
Yeah.
Just a great
getting
friend.
Getting the best cabin in the park out of Oscar.
That's right, getting the best cabin in the park.
Bon appetit.
Morning.
Good morning to you, too.
Hello, Neil.
Hey, Leora, what are you doing here?
Oh, nice to see you, too.
I'm sorry, I thought you lived in Medford for some reason.
Born and raised right here in Ashland. And you, do you live around here?
Neil, old boy. Hey, how you doing, buddy? Look at you. Mr. Big Time now.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're gonna introduce me to your utterly gorgeous lady friend?
Leora, this is Fitch. Fitch, this is Leora.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, too.
Yeah. Aren't you easy on the eyes?
Fitch, can we talk later, do you think?
Oh, don't be silly. I'll join you for a drink. But don't worry. Even though you're the only friend I know with a job from my own.
Fitch.
Unless you'll be moving this little gathering back to your new cabin.
Fitch.
You sly old dog. I see how you operate. My friend here's got a nice cabin. You really must see it. It comes with a nice cot. Probably fit the two of you in a pinch.
Jeez. Oh, I'm sorry. So sorry.
Oh, it's okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. Here, let me.
It's okay.
I'm an idiot. I'm sorry.
Here, please let stop.
Let me. Oh. Hey, down he goes.
I should go.
I'm sorry. Sorry.
$25 per week. Over there, you've got your bathroom. Now, our maid quit about a month ago, so we'd appreciate it if you clean up after yourself.
Thought I should come by, see if you needed any help. Is that it?
Yep. Strange to think everything I own fits in a duffel bag.
Nothing wrong with traveling late. We should probably talk about the other day.
It's not necessary.
It is. From what I remember, it is. Sonny seems to think it happened because I wasn't prepared for you to get out of here before me. And since I've never known the woman to blow smoke, amazing, huh? Make it all the way to 60 years old. One moment, I'm back to being a jealous kid. That's stupid. Feel good to be getting out.
Well, it's like you said, friends on the street, hardest ones to make. Tougher ones to lose.
that mean we're friends?
Not yet.
Leora! Roy! Anybody, it's Neil!
Hey, what are you doing sleeping on a bench?
Looking for you.
God, that's a trip. Everyone was gone?
Yeah. Just when things were getting better.
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, look at you. Wow. I don't think I've ever seen you out of work clothes.
Yeah, don't I look good?
Oh, yeah, you look great. It's a great look on you.
Yeah, I'm heading over to the Black Sheep for happy hour with the girlfriends. They have killer drink specials. Jimmy, the bartender, makes the best Long Island iced teas in town. Oh, God, I look like hell.
I think you look beautiful.
All right, Neil, what's up?
Nothing, what?
Oh, come on. First you tell me I look nice, now I look beautiful. Spill.
I don't know, I've just been, you know, thinking about you, us, a lot.
Neil.
When I'm with you, I feel like things just fit. I mean, I like myself. It's like you're a best friend. You gotta feel that too, right?
Neil.
Okay, fine. You're in your 20s, I'm in my 40s. What's the big deal?
Are you nuts? That's a driver's license and a 9-year-old. Don't get weird on me. You okay?
Yeah. I'm just out of sorts. I'm gonna sit here and think for a little bit. I'll take the next bus.
Goodbye, Neil.
Right.
About you, wondering if you need anything. Things are good with me. I got a new job, nothing fancy, office manager for a medical practice up in Medford. And I moved in with Tommy. He just bought a really cute fixer-upper in town, and it needs a woman's touch. Anyway, give a call when you can. Miss talking with you.
To the questions you're asking? Are you going to answer me? You've asked a lot of questions. You're angry. And now I ask you, do you really want to know the answers to the questions you're asking? Or are you just venting?
This is crazy.
I know what you're thinking. And I talk to everyone. All the time. In their own voice. The question is, who listens? From the highest mountain, it has been shouted. In the lowest place, its whisper has been heard. Through the corridors of all human experience, this truth has been echoed. Love is the answer. You have projected the role of parent onto God, and have thus come up with a God who judges and rewards or punishes. You have created a fear-based reality around love. And this fear-based love reality dominates your experience of love. Indeed, it actually creates it. Is it fear that you need in order to be, do, and have what is intrinsically right? Must you be threatened in order to be good? And what is being good? Who gets the final say about that? I tell you this, you are your own rule maker. You set the guidelines. Love is all there is. Yes, you've heard it before. In fact, I've even put it on a bumper sticker for you. But in times of trouble, in times of worry, doubt, or fear, you choose to forget. What you should do is answer the simple question, what would love do now? To live your life without expectation, without the need for specific results. That is freedom. Remember, you are constantly in the act of creating yourself. You are, in every moment, deciding who and what you are.
You decide this largely through the choices you make regarding who and what you feel passionate about. Gotta tell you, I'm a little worried about what people might say when I tell them I'm having a conversation with you. Worry is the activity of a mind that does not understand its connection with me. Do you remember the question, what would love do now?
Of course.
Answer that question, Neil, and I will be there. Always. In all ways. Suffering has nothing to do with events, but with one's reaction to them. What's happening is merely what's happening. How we feel about it is another matter.
I just want my life back.
You can't have anything you want.
I'm sorry.
What are you sorry for?
You just said I can't have anything I want.
That's right.
What?
You can't have anything you want.
I can't have anything I want.
Correct.
Well, that doesn't make sense.
Sure it does. Your very request is one of lack, and you saying you want a thing only works to produce that precise experience, wanting, in your reality.
Yeah.
Should I therefore punish you for making a choice that I myself have laid before you? This is a question you must ask yourself before you would assign me the role of a condemning god. Unendingly have you beseeched me, show myself, explain myself, reveal myself. I am doing so here in terms so plain you cannot misunderstand. I am here. Right here. Right now. Now is the time to go to your God space. More than ever. It will bring you great peace of mind. And from a peaceful mind do great ideas flow. Ideas which could be solutions to the biggest problems you imagine yourself to have.
Can you imagine this is too big a problem for me to solve? Is getting out of this jam too big a miracle for me to handle? I understand that you may think it's too big for you to handle, even with all the tools I've given you, but do you really think it's too big for me?
Sometimes you frustrate the hell out of me.
I would think that'd be a good thing.
Is this supposed to be funny?
Well, who do you think invented humor?
Achoo!
Bless you.
I don't know what you want from me.
Neil, you've got me all wrong. And you've got you all wrong, too. I don't want anything from you other than for you to be happy. But you think you are below me, when in truth we are all one. There is no separation. I want for you what you want for you. Nothing more, nothing less. I am not concerned about your worldly success. Only you are. You are not to worry about making a living. True masters are those who have chosen to make a life rather than a living. Go ahead, do whatever you really love. Do nothing else. You have so little time. How can you think of wasting a moment doing something for a living that you don't like to do? That is not a living. That is a dying.
Neil? Neil? What are you having me type?
Still trying to figure that out. What time is it?
Neil. It's amazing.
No, what's amazing?
This stuff is distracting me while I'm at work.
Oh.
And I love it. I don't care if this is going to sound weird or what people might think about me for saying something like this, but I've been asleep, stuck in this perpetuating nightmare of a life, primarily built on fear and doubt.
Do you really want to know how much time I've spent in my life worrying about how I was going to make a living? Worried about making ends meet? I don't want to spend my life making a living, Neil. I want to spend my life making a life. Life that makes a difference. A life built on love and compassion. And this stuff, Neil, I'm even rereading things. I've already finished. Do you hear what I'm saying to you?
I do. Listen, I gotta tell you, it's like I'm just standing by. I'm just taking dictation. Like, I can't stop.
Why would you?
Leora, this is gonna be a book. Not just one book. This should complete book one. I've already got six more filled with material for book two.
I better get busy.
Thank you. Listen, I know I'm not paying you.
Stop.
I don't expect you to work for free.
Neil, we're friends. Besides, just think of all the money I'll be saving on therapy.
Okay. I want to make a deal. If something does happen from this, I want to share some of the profits with you.
If you want to create abundance for yourself, create it for someone else.
Did I write that?
My friend, you got yourself a deal.
Oh. Doesn't fit into your line of books. Well, that's the point. It's not supposed to fit into anybody's line of books. Actually read your own mail. Hello.
Neil Walsh?
Yeah, it used to be.
Bob Friedman, Hampton Roads Publishing.
Hey, Bob. You took the dare.
Yes. I like your style, Neil. Don't get what you want, go right to the top. Exactly what I would do if I was a man in your position.
What exactly is my position?
You're about to become a published author, Neil.
You're kidding.
I never kid about money. We're gonna start out with 5,000 copies.
Okay, what happens after my family gets done reading it, Bob?
Optimism! I like that.
I believe in the book.
So do I. Which is why we're putting this on the fast track.
Okay.
My office will call your people, they'll work out the details.
Okay, well, Bob, I am my people.
Not anymore, Neil. Now you've got yourself a partner. I'll be in touch. Gotcha.
The woman's name is Sharon Parker. She's a pro. Trust me, Neil, it shows. Just let me do the talking.
Okay, what about Warner Books? Are we still gonna meet with them?
Well, I'll circle back next week if I have to, but Putnam is the future. Remember, don't react to anything Sharon says. This game is won without emotion.
Yeah.
All right? Okay? Now let's go have some fun. I'm sure you're very aware that we've had numerous inquiries from other majors about Neil's book.
Any offers?
Aren't there always, Sharon?
Well, that's what makes life interesting, don't you think, Bob?
And did you have an offer in mind, Sharon?
Well, before we get to that, I've been in this business for over half my life. And with the exception of 4 years at one of the giant firms, I've been with Putnam. And I think even Bob will agree that that is pretty rare in our business. People have no loyalty. Truth is, the world we live in is getting tougher. Times are changing.
How much, Sharon?
Now, you probably wonder why I am telling you all of this.
How much, Sharon?
I am telling you all of this because there is, at Putnam, I believe, a soul behind the company. Yes, we have a lot of titles, but we also have the ability to maintain the soul of a small press like Bob's. And when I heard that Hampton had your title, I was pleased.
Sharon, how much?
We are prepared to offer you $1 million for the worldwide rights to Conversations with God.
Thank you for the nice words. I really appreciate them, as I'm sure Neil does. And I agree with you. Putnam does have a soul. They also have buying power. And unfortunately, at that number, Hampton Roads will have to pass. Thank you for coming out. Neil?
Mm-hmm.
Shall we?
Yeah, I thought we were coming here with a very generous offer today, Bob.
So did I. This guy is booked back to back, solid for the next 2 months, Sharon. I can't print the book fast enough. And I think we can both agree this is merely the tip of a very big iceberg. Come on, Sharon. I thought you said you liked the book.
I do like the book, Bob. And I'm prepared to give you 1 million reasons why I like it.
We can do 1 million on our own. In fact, I'll send you a postcard when we do. Neil? Time to go.
Thank you.
Wait for it. That's a lot of money. I said...
Bob!
Wait for it.
$1.5 million. Take it or leave it.
So why do you want the book?
Well, you might think this is a little old-fashioned. But I think your book could change the world. It's
yours. It's hers, Bob.
It's mine.
Of course. At 1.5 million.
Yes, Bob. At 1.5 million.
Neil, why don't you pick up the check for us? I'm going to walk Sharon out, tie up a few loose ends. I'll be back in a few minutes.
Okay. Bob, thank you. Thank you, Sharon.
Congratulations, Neil. Michael?
Okay.
Nicely
now
done.
Listen, I'm so glad you think so. The book cover, we're keeping that. I have some very definite ideas about it. I've got the artwork already laid out. I think you just need to take a look at it. Come by the office if you want something.
Could I have the check, please?
Sorry about that.
Not at all. What are you reading?
Economics. I have a test in 45 minutes, and I'm dreading it.
Oh, you in university?
12 credits to go, and I'm done.
Just in time for summer, I guess.
Well, maybe by next summer. I'm lucky. I have a son. Between daycare and my other job and class, things they move a little slower in my life.
Well, good luck on the test.
Thank you. More coffee?
No, I'm so very good. Thanks. Thank you.
Oh, my God.
My
My God, too.
This is a small percentage?
It was a really big check.
Neil, forgive me. I don't want to seem ungrateful, but this is a lot of money.
Well, I thought you could use it for the remodel, you know? You could do it upright.
I can't take this.
Leora, I want you to have this. Also, by the way, we did make a deal, right?
Tommy, Neil's here.
Tell him to come in.
You're staying for breakfast. Okay. We need to celebrate.
Okay.
What are you having?
Neil, it'll add 1, maybe 2 days in Russia. That's all they're asking.
Well, I don't care what they're asking. I'm not gonna do it. I mean, I haven't been home in 2 weeks. I'm tired.
Just think about it.
Just think about it. Whose side are you on, anyway?
God's.
You know, I wish I knew. Maybe it's because I've screwed up so much in my life. I don't know. But what I do know is that this is not about me. It's about Leora, I think.
I've been to your lectures, Mr. Walsh, and I read your book about how God is this friendly God and the universe is a friendly place.
And you don't believe that?
I believe your God is a vengeful God. I adopted my son when he was 6 months old because I was told I could never have children. And we never told Jimmy that he was adopted until he was old enough to understand what that meant. And at 14, we decided it was time. His grades fell off. His whole attitude changed. I mean, he got in trouble at school. It was a big mess. And he was angry at his mother for giving him up. He was angry at us for telling him. And he was angry at everything in his life. The only way to calm him down was to promise that when he turned 18, we would find his mother. No matter the cost, no matter how long it took, we promised him that he would get to meet his mother.
And did his attitude change?
Marginally, but the son we once knew, the son we loved so dearly, was gone. And he never called me mother again. And on Jimmy's 18th birthday, he was killed on a motorcycle. A drunk driver killed my Jimmy. So please enlighten me on your definition of a friendly God, Mr. Walsh, because I don't see a friendly God putting parents who love their son unconditionally through something like this. What does your God say now, Mr. Walsh?
I'm sorry, baby. You'll never love anyone.
What is your name?
Georgia.
Georgia? Your son died so that you could keep your promise to him. His mother died a few years ago. And his passing was the only way that he could be with her.
Where did that come from?
Neil.
Honestly, Leora, I don't know what just happened in there. What if I made all that stuff up?
Did you?
I don't know. I don't know where any of that came from.
Yes, you do. Neil.
Yeah? Okay, go ahead. Book the extra days in Russia.
I already did.
Here's your plane ticket. You're on the 10 o'clock.
Thanks for everything, and I'll see you in New York.
Just a minute.
feel abandoned, for I am always with you. I will not leave you. I cannot leave you, for you are my creation and my product. My daughter, my son, my purpose, and myself. Call on me, therefore, wherever and whenever you are separate from the peace that I am. I will be there.
Thank you.
have a book for me to sign?
No, I don't. But I wanted to thank you for writing it. Reading it didn't convince me that you're having conversations with God. It convinced me that I am too.